Welcome to Passive Investing School, where you'll learn how to get started on your journey for investing in multifamily apartments as a passive investor. You'll hear tips and case studies from actual real estate investors sharing their wisdom with you so you don't make the same mistakes they did and so you can be set up for success with your investments. Here's your host, Chris Tracy.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the show. Got another awesome guest for you on here today. I've got Greg Dickerson with us today. What's going on, Greg?
Hey, Chris, how you doing, man? It's a beautiful day.
Yeah. A lot more beautiful now that I got you here in my presence. I'm so excited to be talking with this gentleman because I never really knew how awesome he is until I started to research him a little bit more. I discovered Greg on Bigger Pockets, and if you're not connected to him, you really should make friends with him on there. Great website, great platform to connect with, really movers and shakers like Greg on there. You know, he's really doing some big things on there. I became attracted to Greg on there because of what he writes and all the value that he publishes in there. You know, he's one of the top contributors in there. His name and face is always in there. He's always answering questions for people that are wanting to know how to get started in real estate investing, you know, developing, flipping houses, multifamily apartment buildings, all kinds of great stuff. And I was like, you know what? I got to have Greg come on my show and I got to interview him and ask him, you know, some really, I think, fundamental questions that people, they really should get, you know, wrap their mind around when they're trying to get started buying these apartment buildings and analyzing deals. And so many people nowadays, I think they get caught up. And I was having this conversation with Greg recently about, you know, how to get started looking at deals. And everyone's caught up in kind of like, hey, well, what's the best software I should use? Should I get Michael Blanks or should I use this? Should I use that? You know, there's free calculators on Bigger Pockets. And it becomes Calgon take me away after a while with, okay, well, what the heck do I do? Especially for someone, you know, you guys at home watching this, you know, you probably may be paralyzed by the analysis of crunching these numbers and figuring out how to move forward in all this. And Greg, he seemed to have a nice, simplified, down-to-earth answer for me. So I wanted to bring him on so he could expand upon that, share it with everyone on YouTube and the internet in general. So before we get into all that, Greg, how about if you just give us the elevator pitch, give us the backstory. I mean, how did you get to the level of awesomeness that you're at today? And the reason why I say that, Greg is really a force to be reckoned with because he does coaching and he helps a lot of people, you know, in the educational aspects of real estate investing. And he's a beast because he coached a lot of really high-level people in the space like Joe Fairless. And I'm sure you've probably heard his name, you know, unless you've been living under a rock. So Greg is really a guy that you want to get to know and, you know, check him out. So without any further ado, Greg, I'm not going to belabor the point anymore. I think the people at home get it. I don't want to pump you up too much and swell up your head and boost your ego too much. But yeah, no, Greg's a great guy, really humble, really down to earth, and brilliant to say the least. So talk to us, Greg. How are you doing?
So yeah, everything's going well. We are, I'm here on the East Coast in Charlottesville. We just got off of a, you know, 100 degree weather heat wave, and it feels like, you know, normal, actually fall temperatures now. We're in the, you know, 60s and 70s at night and 80s during the day, so it's much nicer. But yeah, so I appreciate all the kind words that, you know, thank you so much. So I'm 52 now. I've reached a point in my career where, you know, I want to give back, and I'm going to try to sit still. I usually talk and I'm animated with my hands, but the microphone was hitting my collar. So I'm going to kind of be sitting a little bit more still. And I've got a lot of great content, podcasts, YouTube videos on my website. You can find those links, gregdickerson.com. But you'll see in the videos, I use my hands a lot and I move a lot, but this microphone's being a pain today. So I'm going to sit still. But yeah, so anyways, 23 years in the real estate, you know, investing and development business. I started as a remodeling contractor back in 1997, doing anything and everything, handyman remodeling work. And I took that company from $250,000 to $30 million in 7 years, more particularly in about 5 years, that big growth spurt, and became one of the largest builder developers in my area. I started 12 other companies along the way during that time period as well. And you know, so I'm a serial entrepreneur, real estate developer, and, you know, I'm also, you know, coach and mentor, as you mentioned. And, you know, that's really what I did in my business and in all of the other companies that, that I built and grew with other people, is just found great operators and coached them and you know, taught them how to be business owners, entrepreneurs, you know, how to lead, delegate, motivate. So, you know, you've heard the term, you know, an inch wide and a mile deep. You know, I'm a mile wide and a mile deep because I've done every type and class of real estate, you know, pretty much from the ground up, as well as value add type stuff. I've built remodeled homes and buildings, you know, hundreds of them. I've flipped properties, you know, just any number of things. So I've done, you know, pretty much a little bit of everything, you know, developed raw land, all those types of things. So I've got a depth of experience that, like, is what you're referring to. That's what kind of comes out in the questions that I answer. I get that a lot from people that are saying, man, your depth is just different and it's interesting. And, you know, what really motivated me is I have a lot of clients and investors and partners I work with that go to these courses and they get educated and they do these different things. And there's just so much misinformation out there. And you get a lot of people that, you know, study something on the internet and then try to answer questions or put information out, and they've never actually done a deal. You know, so I'm like, you know what, I've got all this experience. I've gained all this wisdom, meaning I've lost a lot of money. I've made a lot of mistakes. That's how you get wisdom, because I didn't go to college. I'm not formally educated. I didn't have, you know, official coaches or mentors in the spaces necessarily like you have today teaching. Because back when I started in 97, the internet wasn't even a thing. And underwriting, like we're going to talk about today, or analyzing deals, was all done on the back of a piece of paper. You know, we didn't have, you know, complicated spreadsheets back then. We did it all by hand. So that's how I learned and how I came up. And I'm a very simplified, straight to the point kind of individual, whether it's answering questions, looking at deals, studying a business. You know, I'm a 60-second guy. I can look at a deal and within the first, you know, minute or two, know whether or not it's a good deal. You know, just, it really isn't that complicated. It's dollars in, dollars out. It's market share, it's comps, it's, you know, whatever it is, industry averages. You know, if you know your business and if you know the numbers and the metrics and the KPIs of your industry, you can easily and quickly analyze any deal within a matter of minutes to know if you've got something or not, or if there's potential or not. Now, that being said, you know, obviously I couldn't predict a Facebook or a, you know, Amazon or Uber or things like that. But if you're looking at an existing company, an existing asset, or developing a piece of property, it's pretty easy to understand whether or not, you know, that has scalability, if it's profitable, or if it's even going to work. So, you know, I try to just break it all down to simple, you know, concepts and dollars in, dollars out. I mean, it's really that simple, you know, and just, you know, very straightforward. So that's me in a nutshell.
I like that. My ears really started to perk up as soon as you said, you know, I can analyze a deal in 1 minute and I can take a look at it really quick. And with that, let's piggyback off of that, Greg, and let's jump into, okay, so we've got someone watching this video. They want to go out and buy an apartment building. They never did a deal before. They realize that they have to arm wrestle with this beast of analyzing numbers one way or another. So they got people telling them, you know, you should get Michael Blank software. It's awesome. Oh, well, Joe Farrell's will give you a free one if you email him. Oh, but there's, you know, these calculators on bigger pockets. Oh, you know, should I just use a calculator? Should I write it on a napkin? Should I just do the math the hard way? You know, should I use a slide rule? You know, I don't know, you know, like these are archaic tools. Are they, should I just look at the sun and just, you know, kind of, you know, somebody watching this, you know, what's the most, let's say, minimum, easiest, way and most feasible way to get started analyzing a deal? Let's say they actually get over the hurdle of they met a broker, they hit it off with the broker. Broker say, hey, I like this deal you got going on here. All right, well, broker actually sends the financials to the guy. So now, assuming that the guy has everything that he needs, you know, he's got the rent roll, he's got the T12, he got the offer memorandum, you know, whisper price, all of that is in place. Now you gotta, you know, for lack of a better word, we'll say you got a newbie, right? So they're sitting there saying, oh God, well now what do I do? I got some numbers. And how can someone, you know, at a bare minimum on a shoestring, you know, get started and start to make heads or tails of what they have in front of them, assuming they have all the appropriate you know, fundamental metrics that they need to get started analyzing a deal?
So, you know, Warren Buffett always says, if you can't put your business plan on the back of a cocktail napkin, it's too complicated. I say the same thing about a deal. It's really, it's dollars in, dollars out. It's net operating income minus the operating expenses. It's really that simple. Then you have to calculate your debt service based on the loan, your equity payback, and see if the deal works. So it's really very simple. Again, it can be done on a sheet of paper with a pencil. You know, you just take the offering memorandum. So the first thing to understand is what underwriting is. Underwriting is what insurance companies do, and it's what lenders do. So it's the process of taking on risk, financial risk for a fee. And the term underwriting actually comes from back in the day, the individual wrote his name underneath, you know, the amount of financial risk they were willing to take on in the insurance industry or loan industry. So, you know, that's where the term underwriting comes from, is literally the signature underneath that risk that they were taking on. So what we're really doing is we're really analyzing. So in the world of real estate at the institutional level, they have analysts, and that's what a real estate analyst does. They look at the deal and they analyze and scrutinize the deal, which is what you're doing. So when you get a offering memorandum from a broker, and if there isn't one, you have to kind of do your own, stuff. And there's a difference between due diligence and, you know, underwriting or analyzing. Due diligence is a whole process that includes the analyzing. So analyzing is the only thing we're talking about today. So understand that what you're really doing is you're analyzing and scrutinizing the numbers. That's what you're doing. So when you think of it that way, then it really simplifies the process. So if there's an offering memorandum, you want to read through it so that you understand the property and what's going on with it and the story of it, you know, so that you understand the occupancy, the vacancy, you understand, you know, where the loss to lease is coming from, concessions that they may or may not be giving. And you understand, you know, the effective rents and, you know, the economic occupancy and or vacancy of the property, meaning how many units are actually paying rent. That's economic occupancy. You know, you could have 100% occupied building, but if they're not all paying the rent, then you're going to have an economic vacancy and or occupancy of that unit. So you're just trying to understand those things. So really, you know, you want to read the memorandum, get the story of the property. Then once you understand the story, that kind of helps when you're looking at the numbers, and then you get the numbers and you want actual numbers. And, you know, everybody uses the T12. I like to go back as far as I can. You know, they've got the whole history of the property. I'll take it because I like to see the whole story. But we're talking about a quick analysis. You want to get the trailing 12. The T12 is a trailing 12. That's really a P&L. At the end of the day, you know, we have all these fancy terms in real estate for everything, you know, loan defeasance, this, that, and the other. A T12 is just the trailing 12 months, the previous 12 months of history of income and expenses on the property, a P&L, just like a business. So you're going to have dollars in, dollars out. So, you know, you want to get those. If you can get tax returns to back that information up, great. If you get bank statements to back it up even further, great, because that's what you're trying to do. You're really trying to take what they're telling you their income and expenses are, and you're just trying to verify that information, number one. And number two, you're trying to derive what is the true net income of the property. And then once you get there, you've got that bottom line. And then again, so then you look at, if it's a $10 million property and you need $3 million in equity, you're going to get a 70-30 loan. Then you say, okay, my equity payback, let's just use simple numbers. And this is quick, this is as easy as it is. So if you've determined that the net operating income on that property is $600,000 a year, let's say it's a 6 cap, you know, capitalization rate, which is what properties trade at based on their net operating income. Let's say it's $600,000 on that $10 million property. And you're gonna raise $3 million in equity at 6%. That's $180,000 a year. And you're going to finance the remaining $7 million for 4.5% for 30 years. Well, you're going to have a payment there that's probably going to be around, you know, what, $60,000 a month, something like that, for $7 million, you know, somewhere around there, $40,000, $50,000 a month, whatever it is. So you take that, let's say that's $600,000 a year, and you got $180,000 a year over here. That's, you know, $780,000 a year that the debt service between equity and debt, not debt service, but the cost, you know, of that property to operate is going to cost you. So you have to have enough cash flow to service that. So then you take a look at the net operating income, you know, and if it's, you know, 600 something thousand, well, that dog doesn't hunt, you know, you're upside down. So now you got to back up and start looking at, okay, how does it work? Maybe you can go to interest only. So you take that 7 million times 4.5% interest only. Now you're talking about, let's make it 5 to make easy math. So that's 350,000 a year if it's interest only. Then you've got another 180. So that's 485,30. So now if your net operating income is 600,000, you got 530, you got a $70,000 cushion. Not great on a $10 million property, but it works. So, I mean, it's really that simple. And that can be done right there on the back of a piece of paper real quick for a first real quick look at a deal to even decide whether or not you want to go further. So that's how I do it in 60 seconds or less. I just take a look at what's the net operating income, what are the, you know, what is the debt service going to be? How can I mitigate debt service if it doesn't work out on a traditional 30-year, you know, amortized payback? Do I need to go interest only? You know, what's the equity payback? You know, I put those two numbers together to see how much, you know, cushion there is. Then once you do that, then you start looking at all the other value add and things like that, and, you know, the vacancies and the occupancies and stuff like that. And then you can dig deeper in the deal. But if you do that first initial analysis, that can be done. Like I said, it's a very simple spreadsheet. A lot of the calculators you're talking about are just basically spreadsheets. So then some of them might have some notes and tutorials that explain the numbers and how they derived at the numbers along the way, you know, so that may be, I haven't seen everybody's calculator, but there is no secret calculator. It's a spreadsheet. Whatever anybody has at the end of the day, it might just be hosted online so you can plug numbers in or whatever, like the Bigger Pockets ones. That's just a spreadsheet that's hosted online that you just plug numbers in, and it'll calculate cash on cash and IRR, and it's got an amortization schedule, and, you know, it's got all those things. But, you know, again, that's just a spreadsheet. You can download that for free on the internet, you know, and, you know, multifamily deal analyzer spreadsheet, you know, and there's free stuff out there that have the amortization schedules, the IRRs and things like that. And you can even have it, if you're really good with spreadsheets, what I do is you can set that thing up to where, as you put the numbers in the net operating income, if you want, you know, a certain cash on cash return and a certain IRR over a 5-year period, you can have that set up to where it'll automatically calculate an offering price based on those parameters of the income and expenses that you plug in. So that's really where the advantage of a spreadsheet comes in, is being able to, it's just automating this process. And then you can also compress the rent roll. You can compress, you know, the unit mix. You can compress, you know, things like that. You can also add the, you know, the value add component and have that information in there. So it just, it goes in there for your renovations. So there's some advantages to having spreadsheets, so that, you know, you can do that unit mix and how much you're going to do per each unit for renovations, and it automatically brings that back into the formula for the overall deal. But at the end of the day, quick, you know, 60-second analysis, look at the total income in, look at the expenses out. Does it work based on the debt service and the equity payback that you have to pay, you know, annually to your investors, just to make the deal work first and foremost? And then, you know, once you get through that process, then you can start digging deeper. And then all you're really doing is verifying the information that's being supplied to you. And, you know, the brokers are going to give you what they're going to give you. You have to take it for what it's worth, and you got to do your own homework, because their job is to make the deal look as good as they can make it look and try to get as much money as they can get. So they're going to sell you on what you can do. So when I'm analyzing, I always take a very conservative approach. I underwrite and analyze deals based on actuals. And I never assume that I'm going to earn more money in rent or be able to raise the rents. I assume I'm going to have to reduce rent. So I do scenario and stress tests, meaning, you know, I take into account, I'm going to have to do something to remain competitive because it is a competitive environment. And, you know, whatever reason people start buying houses, quit renting, whatever, I want to increase my vacancy rate. Be conservative. I want to say I can't raise rents. I'm actually going to have to reduce rents. How does that look if I have to actually back up? Can I be competitive? You know, is this deal still going to work? So those are the factors that I take into account. And then you also want to have the upside too, because it is a, you know, if it's a value add, you know, you want to be able to see what's it, you know, if this business plan works, how's that going to work out in the future? So, I mean, it really is that simple. It's not a super complicated process. At the end of the day, it's just a spreadsheet. You can build your own, you can get them for free out there. You can buy, you know, these programs. There's a lot of value maybe to some of those programs because, you know, they might have some descriptions of these different things. But again, you know, you can find all that information free on the internet.
Yeah. And Michael Blank's is not too bad. I have that one. I mean, it's under $200. Mm-hmm. I mean, template videos.
Right. And it explains everything and how the numbers come together and all that. And, you know, and gives you the process of what I just explained. You know, hey, go talk to the broker, dig into this. Industry averages, I'm sure it gives you industry averages, you know, so that you kind of know what's going on out there. So there is some value in those things, but it's just a spreadsheet.
Yeah. That's fabulous, Greg. Thank you so much for that. Kind of a side note is, I didn't want the viewer here to start to go off in some other tangent, because we started to talk about debt service and, you know, financing conversation. Now, that's just a simple phone call to a loan officer, right? I mean, a mortgage broker can help someone navigate, you know, the lending environment. It's not like, you know, you have to sit home. If you're just getting started with this whole thing, it's not like you have to be like, oh God, you know, debt service cover ratio, and kind of, you know, it seems like just one more thing that a person could get overwhelmed with. Oh, can I get a, you know, Fannie or Freddie loan, or, you know, so on and so forth. It's kind of like, you know, don't worry about all of that, right? For the most part, just be like, you know, build a relationship with a loan officer. Like in my group, we have an in-house mortgage broker, so he does all that. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to go down the rabbit hole with the financing part of it. You just be in communication with him. I mean, would you recommend that? Is that kind of how you do it, Greg? Or, you know, so people don't get, you know, caught up in the whole finance.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, I'm different, obviously, because just the experience and all that. But yeah, I guess, you know, in the beginning, yeah, I relied heavily. I'm just thinking back on my own career. I relied heavily on mortgage brokers to explain the different products that were available and things like that. So at the end of the day, if you've got, you do need to know how to calculate debt service, because you got to make sure that, you know, the loan is going to work. But as far as the debt service coverage ratios, you know, things like that, you know, that's what those spreadsheets do. They calculate all that kind of stuff. And you know, you do need to know what those are so that you know if you have a deal, but you don't need to get hung up on it or worry about it. You know, the mortgage brokers, now again, so on your initial analysis, if you find a deal that looks like it's going to work and you do your homework, you know, then that's a great backstop. You send it to your mortgage broker. They're going to underwrite that deal. That's who's actually going to, you know, literally underwrite it, is the mortgage broker, because they're underwriting the financial risk that their investors are going to take, whether it's Freddie or Fannie, private money, whatever it is. You know, so they're going to vet that deal and they're going to check you. And then also you can send it to a property management company. If you're using a third party property management company, which I suggest everybody do, you know, you send it to them. They will look at your, you know, your operating cost assumptions and your value add assumptions, and, you know, help you determine whether, number one, whether or not you're right and your assumptions are correct. And they'll tell you where they would be. They'll also tell you what their value add suggestions are and return on those investments. So so definitely you want to use your third party people to help you vet, underwrite these deals, but you got to do the first part yourself, make sure it works. You got to know at least what the payments are going to be. But yeah, as far as the debt service coverage ratios, I mean, they're pretty standard. You know, you need a minimum of 1.25, you know, for multifamily, and the higher that number is, the better the deal is, you know, meaning, you know, you have X amount of dollars above $1 to cover the debt service coming in. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's a simple term, but yeah, I wouldn't get hung up on all of it. You know, the key that you want to understand is it's a business. So multifamily property, if you're in the single family world, it's the same exact thing. You've got dollars in, dollars out. You just have more doors, you know, so just think instead of one house, it's 100 houses, and your maintenance expenses are a little bit different, you know, so you want to make sure you vet those and understand. A lot of people leave off stuff like, you know, assuming snow removal, you know, weather events, you know, things like that. People forget those little things, you know, in their underwriting a lot of times. And you got to factor that in. You know, where you're at, you get a lot of snow sometimes, and where I'm at,
oh God,
the South had some unbelievable snows the last few years. So that was like a big expense. A lot of people didn't have factored into their operating costs. So you always want to have those scenario tests, always have those in there. Man, what if I get snow this year? It's going to cost me 10,000. It could cost you 10 grand for snow removal if you have a bad year on some properties, depending on how big it is, you know. So that could be a big expense. You know, things like that. But yeah, you don't want to get hung up on the details. The idea is to get going, take action, get into a deal, find something that works, and then get after it. Leverage your partnerships with your lenders, your property managers, your contractors for the value add side, you know, other investors in the industry that you may be partnering with, and, you know, let them help you bring it all together.
Sweet. All right. Beautiful, Greg. Let's change gears a little bit here and talk about, I don't know, the top pitfalls you're seeing, someone just getting started, analyzing a deal. You know, what tips would you share with a newer financial analysis, syndicator, underwriter, whatever you want to call them, a guy that's trying to make heads or tails of this, whether they're using a napkin or a big template, underwriting spreadsheet, whatever, biggest pitfalls, mistakes to avoid that you've seen that you would recommend a newer syndicator or what have you kind of be on the lookout for?
Right. So one of the biggest things is assuming that you can just automatically assuming you can go in, rebrand a complex, do a bunch of value add and exponentially increase rents year over year over year. So, you know, every market, you're going to reach a point where you just can't go any further in your rents. So you've got to know what that maximum is that you can push rents to if you're looking at the value add approach. You know, so that's one, misestimating that. Sometimes rebranding a building, if a building's been around long enough and it's got a bad reputation, repositioning or rebranding is going to be difficult. So a lot, you know, you can't just go change the sign and go. You have to transform that property so that it doesn't even look the same. Another thing that a lot of people don't do is they don't dig deep enough in terms of the tenants that are in the building and go, you know, what kind of reviews are being posted online? What are the existing tenants saying about the building? You can learn a lot about a property by going online and looking at the reviews, what the actual tenants are saying about the property that are coming and going. You know, things like that. As far as the numbers go, like I said, missing the little things, you know, like different types of operating expenses that may or may not be in there, or that you automatically assume that you can come in and, you know, do this and do that and operate it way better than what the individual that's operating and is doing, may or may not be the case. You may not be able to prove operating efficiencies, you know, so you just got to be real careful and not over assume. You know, again, you always want to be conservative. You always want to assume that you're wrong. And that's one of the biggest things is people don't ask themselves enough. Whenever I look at a deal, whether it's a business opportunity, whether it's real estate, no matter what it is, the first thing I look at is how am I wrong? Once I make my assumptions, once I analyze and I make my assumptions, then I go, how am I wrong? And that's my approach to my property management company, to my lender, you know, to the appraiser, to the, you know, inspectors, you know, things like that. You know, show me where I'm wrong on this deal. Point that out. So when they look at it from that standpoint, you know, everybody wants to find something wrong, right? Everybody wants to say, ah, you missed that. So, you know, use that to your advantage. You know, be a seeker of wisdom, be open to criticism, open to critique, open to advice, and ask for it in every interaction, no matter what you're doing. Always ask, you know, where am I wrong? How am I wrong on this? Where are my assumptions wrong? And what else didn't I ask that I should have? So those are the types of things that are going to uncover things. And it's where people, a lot of people make mistakes is they assume that it's easy, that I can just go in, buy this thing, add washers and dryers, and I'm going to be able to raise the rent $100 a month and they're going to pay it. And I'm going to add all this value to an apartment and cap rates are going to keep going down and all this competition. So what's happening is, you know, a lot of people are, you know, they're getting short-term interest only, which is great during the value add process, but we don't know where rates are going to be 3 years, 5 years from now. We assume they're still going to be low, but we don't know. I mean, you know, the Fed's just people and they make, you know, as we all know, not the best decisions a lot of times in terms of, you know, what's good for the economy and good for real estate. It's all about interest rates right now. The only reason cap rates are so compressed is because interest rates are so low and institutional money is free because interest rates are so low. So that has cap rates compressed. At some point, when the institutions have had enough, and think about 2008 and 9, what happened back then? Debt was commoditized into securities. All the institutions were all over it. So what did that do? Everybody can borrow money. Prices went through the roof. Right now, these properties are the same thing. They are instruments being securitized, just like residential mortgages were back in the day. So the institutions that lent money on these assets, typically in the past, are now buying the assets instead of being the lenders because interest is so cheap. As soon as that changes, they're not buyers anymore. And that's going to change the cap rate scenario because everybody's going to be a seller. Sooner or later in this market, everybody's going to be a seller. And there's a lot going on right now where there's going to be a lot of sellers 3 to 5 years down the road. And, you know, it's supply and demand. If there's a lot of properties on the market, cap rates are going to go up. Values are going to go down. A lot of people are going to get hurt because they're making the assumption automatically that, man, I can buy this thing, increase, you know, rents, cap rates, even if it stays the same or whatever. They're not looking at that scenario stress test. What if the cap rates change 2 points between now and the time I get this done in 5 years? That is a very real thing that can happen quickly. Interest rates can't necessarily go up that quick, that much. I don't foresee, you know, anything that will, you know, affect interest rates like that fast. It could. But I'm not seeing it. And, you know, I didn't see it in 2009 either. You know, rates went up in a couple of years pretty quick there and it tanked the market, as we know. So I'd watch interest rates and I would also watch institutions and follow what they're doing. Like in the self-storage industry right now, a lot of REITs are backing off because it's getting oversaturated in a lot of markets. I would watch multifamily. If REITs start pulling back on multifamily and these other assets, then that's an indication that, you know, your cap rate environment might change.
Wow. All righty then. Yeah, you know, that's funny. And that whole picture you were just painting, it always makes me chuckle that brokers love to grease that wheel too. You know, like it should actually, now talking about brokers that represent sellers, so you being, that it should be on their business card. Oh, well, you could raise the rents. That's the value add. You could raise the rents. You could always raise the rents.
Well, it's brokers on the buy and the sell side. I mean, that's their job, right? And, you know, when you're buying, you know, you want a broker that's the other way. But what is he usually telling you? Oh, man, this is a great deal. You can raise rent, you know.
Yeah.
And when you're a seller, you want the broker that's going to do the same thing for you because you want to get as much as you can for it. So, I mean, that's just their job. That's what they're there to do. So I have no problem with it. I just understand the truth. I take all emotion out of the equation. That's what's so great. And I did a video the other day about, you know, numbers. The truth is in the numbers and the truth will set you free. So if you take all emotion out of the game, the other big mistake people make, the biggest mistake, the number one mistake people make is the feeling the need to have to do a deal because they're going to miss out, you know, and the, you know, the millennials have an acronym for it. They got an acronym for everything. And it's, I can't remember what it is. FMO, fear of missing out. Mm-hmm. I think it is. And, you know, hashtag FMO. So, you know, a lot of people will get in that mode, man. I just need to do a deal. I just need to get in the game. I don't care. I just got to do something so I can, because momentum begets momentum, right? So momentum breeds momentum, success breeds success. So there is a lot of truth to once you get that first deal, then you're off and running. But the biggest mistakes people make in real estate, and they made back in 2009, was feeling like, man, I'm going to miss out if I don't get in the game. And what I'm saying is, I'm not doom and gloom and all that. What I'm saying is that those are the signs to watch for so that you can stay ahead of an economic event or a market cycle so that, you know, you can get out at the right time or sit back and wait to get in at the right time. And it's more important to predict the top of a market than it is the bottom, right? The peak is the most important thing to know whether you're a buyer or a seller. That's the most important thing to know. The bottom doesn't really matter that much, you know, because you can get in anywhere along that curve as long as you're buying or selling, you know, around that peak, or not buying at the peak, but selling at the peak and understanding where you are in that cycle. So I hope my collar is not rubbing as I move my
hand. No, it sounds great. It's
hard for me not to jump around.
You're on fire, Greg. Keep going.
Yeah. So anyway, so don't take that as doom and gloom or anything like that. It's just, these are the mistakes people make. And don't feel like you have to do a deal. Be patient. There's always going to be deals in every market cycle, whether we're going up or down, there's always going to be deals, right? And, you know, it's like Warren Buffett. I love Warren Buffett. And one of my mentors, you know, and, you know, you want to buy when people are selling, you want to sell when people are buying, you know, so contracyclical, right? And then, you know, when the tide goes out, that's when, you know, when, you know, who's been swimming without any trunks on. So, you know, that meaning interest only, highly leveraged, you know, questionable speculative deals that brokers talk people into. So again, you got to remember, we are in the world of sales. We get all these influences everywhere. We're being sold by everybody everywhere that, man, you're missing out. You're missing out. We just closed this deal. We just closed that deal.
Oh, geez. Yeah.
You know, that's easy to get caught up in and feel like, man, I got to do something. I'm going to miss out. But, you know, there's always going to be deals. Every market cycle, I've been in it 23 years, you know, and there's been opportunity in every cycle, including 2009. And prior to that, you know, back in the 80s and all that, you know, I wasn't in the game then. I was, you know, I'm only 52. So the savings loan crisis and all that, people will tell you the same thing. There were opportunities and there were still deals to be had. You know, you just got to pay attention to what's going on, which are interest rates and what the institutions are doing. And I'll tell you what the institutions are doing right now in the multifamily and the office world. They're moving to Class A assets in primary markets and paying stupid cap rates because it's a bond. They're buying trophy assets in primary markets, Class A properties, multifamily and office, because they're looking at it as a bond because they're seeing a bubble in that value add B and C market. So, you know, REITs are very smart. You know, they spend a lot of money doing research, you know, big data, serious, you know, artificial intelligence and analytics. So if you watch the REITs and the moves they're making and you watch the, you know, the debt markets and the credit markets, you can kind of see where the trends are going to stay ahead of the curve.
Greg, what would be the easiest way to for someone to implement that and actually watch these people that you're describing? How would someone actually do that? Like, how do you watch them?
You know, so there's industry articles out there. There's REIT reports, you know, so Real Estate Investment Trust, you know, so like National Real Estate Investor is a magazine publication. that reports on REITs. You know, CB Richard Ellis reports on REITs. They have a lot of great information and articles on their website. You know, Marcus and Millichap, they've got a multifamily report indicator. Cushman Wakefield, Talheimer Cushman Wakefield, you know, they've got some great information out there. So, you know, a lot of the big commercial brokerage houses, a lot of the big apartment houses that just focus on multifamily. There's also multifamily industry magazines that you can look at, and they report on what REITs are doing. And then you can just Google that, you know, multifamily REITs and, you know, reporting and, you know, investment strategies and stuff. And you can look at the actual REITs themselves. And this is a Warren Buffett strategy. So he goes and looks at what the companies themselves are reporting. So if you look at the biggest multifamily operators in the country, you know, especially the public companies, they have to report everything they're doing. So you can go in and read their annual reports, and they will tell you exactly what they're doing, exactly what they're seeing, and exactly what they predict. So that's a great way to get, you know, and that's what these other companies do. They just compile those reports, annual reports that these companies have to file. Mm.
And those are quite objective, right? Now, I know just a couple of minutes ago, I was poking fun at brokers about how they try to sell you the Statue of Liberty. But now these like CBRE, I mean, the Marcus and Millichap, those are brokers, and it is in their best interest for you to go out and buy properties and for them to, you know, make commissions. However, those reports that they do, those are, you know, legit, right? Yeah. Despite the fact that they're trying to make money, and that's how they feed their families is via commissions. But when they say that, you know, X, Y, Z is happening, like that, you can trust that. They're not just trying to blow smoke up your butt just so you run out and buy properties, right? I mean, those are legitimate research.
Oh, yeah, it's legitimate. You know, they're spending a lot of money on those reports with a lot of it's third party, and a lot of it is coming from the REITs and what they're reporting. Now, you could say the same thing about a REIT, right? So you know, as a REIT, you have to report the facts. But as we've seen in you know, the public, well, in corporate America, in the private sector with public companies, we've seen a lot of fudgery, if that's a word, you know, going on with the numbers in the annual reports. They don't always report the truth. You know, they can make their facts sound and look how they make them want them to look in order to manipulate that stock price. Now, I'm not saying that that's going on or that that's what they do. What I'm saying is we've seen that happen with companies in the past. So again, you got to be able to read between the lines, and you got to look at what they're saying, and then go do your own homework and research that. Right. So, you know, but anyways, if they're all saying the same thing, then that's a good indication that there's something out there. So if they're all bullish and they're all saying, hey, we are all now pulling away from these, you know, self-storage deals, especially the CO deals. So there was a big wave in the self-storage industry where you could build a building ground up and you could sell it as soon as you got your certificate of occupancy without even having one lease in place for a unit. REITs were buying those, and then they would take it and they would fill them up. And that's their value add component, right? Of a ground up development. So the developer makes his money just delivering. It's like a spec house, you know, that you're selling to an owner occupant. You sell it vacant. Once it's complete, they pulled away from that. They're not doing that anymore. They want them 50% stabilized or more before they're buying now. Not every REIT, but most of them have switched that model. So that's what you got to look for, is those trends. What are the REITs doing? Because again, they're very smart. They're very sophisticated. They are usually well ahead of the public in terms of what's going on out there that we don't know about behind the scenes with the credit and debt markets. That's why they're making these moves. Mm.
Wow. That's very interesting. So check that out, people. You know, if you're looking for some leisurely reading material, check out all those reports that Greg just mentioned.
Now, if you're beginning, don't worry about all that, right? Yeah. So this is for the Joe Fairlesses. This is for the, Michael's not quite at his level, you know, yet. This is the Grant Cardones. I mean, this is for the guys that are $400-500 million funds, you know, that are at the high levels. The beginner starting out, that's very high level stuff. If you're into that and you want to do some research, great. But your time is better spent looking at deals, vetting deals, that kind of stuff. And mm-hmm. then as you start building, you know, your portfolio and you're starting to get into the bigger assets, that's when that stuff's important. So if you're buying under 100 units, a lot of that stuff's not necessarily going to affect you a whole lot, you know, because it's less units that you have to fill. But when you get into those 200,000-500,000 unit complexes, that's a different animal, you know, and that's where you really got to pay attention to what's going on.
Sure. All right. So if you want to start talking about what's going on, what's new and exciting in your world? You got any deals that you're working on right now that you're excited about? Anything that you wanted to kind of share with the world?
Yeah, so I'm working on some hotel development projects. You know, those are a lot of fun. I've never developed a hotel, so that's one of my goals, is to get a hotel out of the ground, and then also, you know, some high rises. I've never built a high rise, and I've got a lot of mentors that are high rise developers in that world. So I'd like to do something at least 20 stories. So I'm working on a couple of things there that I'll be ready to, you know, announce here pretty soon, and, you know, be able to you know, have people follow along with me. So those are my goals. I do fewer, bigger deals. And then again, you know, I'm just trying to pour into people, help people, build their companies, build their, you know, portfolios. You know, I'm also doing, you know, equity capital. So I get involved in companies as well, if they are interesting and have scale. So I do a number of different things that keeps me busy. And, you know, the coaching and mentoring is a lot of fun. I'm enjoying that. I've done it my whole career in many companies, including my own. So, you know, that's been a lot of fun. And I know you and I are talking about, you know, creating some projects together and putting some books out there and things like that. So I know you've got some big things on the horizon as well. And,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So so exciting times coming ahead.
Yeah, definitely. That's fabulous. You've stoked my fire once again. You got me kind of starting to get pumped up here. But so if people wanted to keep their eye on you, Greg, what's the best way for people to do that? I know you said that you mentioned that you make videos and stuff like that. I mean, is that like on your website, or is it up on YouTube, or?
Yeah. So my website's gregdickerson.com, and my YouTube channel link is there, as well as my podcast. So I make videos. I make them every day, different topics, different things. And then that audio from those videos are uploaded into a podcast so people can listen to however they want. It goes out to LinkedIn, Instagram, you know, Twitter, all those different things. So for wherever people want to get their content, I'm putting stuff out there to reach people where they are and just kind of share the wisdom that I've gained over the last, you know, really, I mean, my career, you know, I joined the Navy in 1985, right out of high school, didn't go to college. So I've learned it all the hard way by doing. So I've got practical boots on the ground experience, making mistakes, doing things right. I've had some really big wins. I've had some really big losses. So, you know, like I said, it's, you know, it's really fun to be able to share those experiences, share that knowledge, everything I've learned over the years. And, you know, that's kind of my legacy, right? I mean, I'm not one of these egotistical guys. I'm going to live forever. It's just that, you know, where much has been given, much is required, right? With great blessing comes great opportunity. I have a strong faith, and I believe it's my obligation. It's my duty to give back. I've been very blessed in my life. You know, I've had a lot of great things happen to me. I work very hard. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I, you know, back in the day, you know, and even now, I mean, I put in 60, 70 hours a week, not like physically at a desk, but just on the phone, looking at deals. I'm on the road every day. You know, after I leave here, I'll get out on the road. I'm going to look at deals. I'm meeting with clients. I'm just doing all kinds of different things. And, you know, so I'm out there all the time and always on the phone answering questions, you know, just doing stuff. And, it's just kind of how I'm wired. So it's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of focus. It's a lot of educating myself, pouring into myself, developing myself as an investor, as a leader, you know, all aspects. So there's a lot over my 30 something year career, but more specifically the last 23 years in real estate construction and development that I'm trying to give back and share. So that's what it's all about. And, just trying to, you know, pass along what was given to me. And I've had a lot of great mentors in my career. I've spent, you know, $300,000-$400,000 on my education. Even though I go to college, I've still spent that much. And then I've had very high level people pour into me, take me under their wing, big developers that are $1 billion, $500 million, you know, kind of people. And, so that's who I learned from. And that's the kind of stuff that I'm passing along. And that's where a lot of those answers that you see, it comes from that. So it's all of that they know, that's been poured into me. Every book, course, seminar I went to, everybody that I deal with and talk to, all of my clients, you know, at some very high levels and some that are starting out, you know, all of that is what's coming through and what I'm trying to share.
Yep. And then once again, just a reminder, Greg's on Bigger Pockets too. Not to mention all the other social media platforms, his website, go check him out there. And yeah, Greg, you're awesome, man. I know I've only known you for a brief time period here, but I'm loving what you have to say, and I'm really feeling these conversations more and more each and every time that I speak with you. So you're definitely a guy that people should make friends with. So
awesome. I appreciate that. Thank you. And same to you. I mean, you're a great guy, and you know, you've got a lot of great things going on, and I'm looking forward to helping you, you know, bring your game to the next level and ramping up your business and your, you know, what you're trying to do to help people just get started out. That's awesome.
Let's go. Let's go. Any final words of wisdom, sir?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess I would say, you know, decide what it is you want to do and then go do it. Just forget the analysis, forget the next course, the next book, the next this, you know, if you've been studying and you've been educating and you're ready, just go do it. Take action, pour into yourself. You want to continue to educate yourself, pour into yourself, but do something with it. Take action. You know, wisdom without action is lost, right? It's just dead. You know, faith without works is meaningless. Meaning you got to put feet under your faith. You got to put feet under your wisdom. You got to put action to the wisdom. So just get out there, you know, decide what you want to do and then go get it done. It's that simple.
Drop the microphone. Boom. Done. Greg Dickerson, everybody. Thank you very much for coming on, sir. And geez, we got to do this again. I'm ready to go like wrestle a bear or something right now, you know,
awesome.
Or an alligator. I don't know. Thank you, man. This is fabulous. I think this is really going to clear the air for people on how to get out of their own way with starting to analyze, not necessarily underwrite, a deal when they get one and, you know, make heads or tails of it in a very practical way. Don't need all these fancy, tricks and software, and you don't need the matrix, just a simple spreadsheet, maybe even a piece of paper and a pencil and a calculator, you know, crunch those different variables that Greg taught us about. And then, put the pedal to the metal and take that action.
Flip the mindset, analyze the deal.
Yeah, definitely. 1,000 thanks. Thank yous, Greg. This was great. Loved it. I think the audience would really be feeling this as well.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you for having me. I enjoyed it.
All right, brother. We're going to do this again real soon, hopefully.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you very much, sir. And enjoy the rest of your day tackling those big hotel development deals or whatever things you're going to conquer.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
All right, sir.
All right, Chris. Bye, everyone.
See you in the next episode.
Thanks for listening to Passive Investing School. Be sure to check out passiveinvestingschool.com to help you with your journey of being a successful passive investor.